Islamophobia. It's a word that is often heard nowadays, and a lot of people don't understand what it means. Islamophobia means an unjustified fear and hatred of Islam. Unfortunately, Islamophobia is becoming widespread nowadays all over the world, but particularly in the West. Many people think that it started after the horrific events of 9/11, whereas it actually began 14 centuries before that. It started when a man called Muhammad ibn Abdullah announced that he received revelation and that the core of it is the belief in the unique oneness of God. Before that, he was loved and respected by the pagan tribes of Arabia and was among them known as the truthful and the trustworthy. But as soon as he said, "There is no God but Allah," they called him a madman, a lunatic, a sorcerer, a magician, a liar, and a poet who had made up the Quran. He was astonished by their change in attitude. He thought, "What happened? Up till a couple of days ago, they used to love me and respect me." Well, Allah revealed to him Quranic verses telling him that it was actually nothing personal at all, and that the problem was actually with the message he was conveying to them. The problem was that they could not accept it. The verse says, "It is not you that they deny, but it is the verses of Allah that the unjust people reject." So Islamophobia actually started 14 centuries ago. One other reason for Islamophobia is the negative representation of Islam by some of its followers. Unfortunately, Muslims today do not project a correct and civilized image of Islam. Another reason for Islamophobia is racism. Islam is still looked upon as the religion of the Arabs, or the religion of dark-skinned people, or the religion of people from the subcontinent of India. It is not viewed as a global religion, which can be the religion of the white man, for instance. In the West, for example, often when someone converts to Islam, he or she faces alienation and is ostracized by society. Islamophobia is also used in an attempt to justify past occupation of the Islamic world, and perhaps to justify the reoccupation of the Islamic world. They like to justify to themselves and to the younger generations why they occupied the Islamic world in the past, or why they have plans to reoccupy it. They say, "These people have a weird religion, a religion full of crazy things. The world will not be safe until we occupy these countries." The methods used by Islamophobes have been very well known and actually very obvious for a long time. The first tool they use is lying. They falsify facts about the Prophet, peace be upon him, and falsify facts about the Quran. Sometimes they use distorted truth or half-truths. They present a certain topic in a distorted way. They say, for example, that the Prophet married a 9-year-old girl. This is a distorted truth. They take advantage of people's ignorance of the Arabic language and of the Holy Quran to manipulate its meanings. They use one of the most hideous tools known in vilifying Islam, which is the cut and paste technique. That is, they get a certain verse or sentence or saying of the Prophet and present part of it out of context. For example, they may say, "See, Muslims have a verse that says, kill them wherever you find them," meaning kill non-Muslims wherever you find them. Well, why don't they complete the verse? Why don't they complete the verse and clarify the context in which it was said? God willing, all these misconceptions will be dealt with in the next episodes. Before the events of 9/11, attacks on Islam were different from attacks after the events. Before 9/11, attacks were always on Muslims, not on Islam itself. Islamophobes would say that Muslims did not understand their religion properly, and that was why they commit immoral acts. After 9/11, however, a new kind of insolence emerged, and they started attacking Islam itself, attacking the Quran and attacking the Prophet, peace be upon him. The new trend was to say that the peaceful Muslims living among others were good because they actually did not understand Islam, while those who were involved in violence or terrorism were the ones who were following the teachings of Islam. In this program, we will address a lot of the controversies and misconceptions that are used to attack Islam in the West and that we were faced with while introducing Islam at churches and universities in Europe, the Americas, and Asia. We will do this through defending Islam, but it must be noted that defending Islam means defending the Holy Quran and the authentic sayings and actions of the Prophet, peace be upon him. In defending Islam, I do not need to defend all of Islamic history. Not everything in Islamic history was glorious. There were, of course, a lot of glorious events, but there were also mistakes and crimes. Muslims were not, are not, and will not be angels. Defending Islam does not necessarily mean defending the opinions of religious scholars. All opinions are subject to being right or wrong. Any scholar is liable to express some wrong opinions despite being knowledgeable. Therefore, our approach in defending Islam will be defending the Holy Quran and the authentic Sunnah, or traditions and sayings of the Prophet, peace be upon him. In the coming episodes, we will be addressing controversies and misconceptions pertaining to Islam, such as the issue of Darwinism and evolution. Can I be a Muslim yet believe in Darwinism? Can I be a Muslim yet believe in evolution? I was at Oxford University around 3 years ago, and there were a number of Turkish youths preparing a large auditorium where the Turkish Prime Minister Erdogan was to give a speech. When it was time for prayer, I noticed that one of them had stayed behind. So I asked him, "Why didn't you go to pray?" He answered, "Because I'm an atheist." I replied, "Why do you call yourself an atheist? Here you are volunteering with the Islamic Society and seem happy to welcome Mr. Erdogan." He said, "You see, I am studying biology and I believe in the theory of evolution." The question here is, would it have made sense for him to go and pray with the others? Is there a difference between evolution and Darwinism? We will be addressing all that, God willing. Another source of controversy about Islam is that some of the verses of the Quran say that Allah guides whomsoever He wills to good and leads whomsoever He wills astray. So how can He lead me astray and then judge me and punish me for that? We will address this too. Next is the misconception that Islam was spread through wars, by force, by the sword. I was once challenged by someone who told me, "If you don't believe that Islam was spread through wars, go back and read about your history, about all the Islamic armies that stormed through the east, west, north, and south to spread there is no God but Allah." Did Islam really spread through the force of the sword? A lot of atheists today have become so because of the dilemma of evil and good in the world. They say, "How can there be a God when there is so much evil, so many problems, so many wars, so many natural disasters? Innocent children are suffering and dying from terrible illnesses like cancer. Could there be a God with all of this going on?" After one of my lectures about Islam at an American university, one of the students stood up and asked me candidly, "Couldn't your prophet have been as brave as Abraham Lincoln, the American president who signed an act abolishing slavery? Mention one single Quranic verse or one saying of your prophet that prohibits slavery. Besides, you also have in your religion what is called malakat al-yamin, or concubines. In other words, your religion permits a man to have a sexual relationship out of wedlock with a slave girl he owns. Is that true? And if it's true, how could Islam permit that?" We will talk about all that. We will also talk about one of the most serious issues, which is the issue of the punishment for apostasy or leaving Islam. How can you claim that there is no coercion in religion, yet if someone converts to Islam, he isn't allowed to leave it? After one of my lectures at a church in the US, someone stood up and said, "Okay, let's say that I am now convinced with all you said and want to embrace Islam. Then after a few months or years, I decided to back out. Won't you people kill me?" What is the correct Islamic explanation to these questions? In 2006, after a meeting with journalists in Denmark, in the wake of the Prophet Muhammad caricature controversy, one of the journalists approached me with many questions about women's issues in Islam. He said, "You mentioned in your lecture that men and women are equal in Islam. So how come women inherit half what men do?" We will also address many controversies concerning women, such as the issue of hijab. If men and women are equal, why don't men have to cover their hair too? And why do women have to cover their hair in the first place? One day I was approached by a European lady together with her Egyptian Muslim husband. She had with her a translation of the Holy Quran in her language. She said, "I have read this book and really like it, but I will never become a Muslim." I asked, "Why?" She said, "Because I will never worship a God who commands my husband to beat me. Haven't you guys read that? See, it is even put in an imperative form as a command. It says, 'As for those women on whose part you fear disobedience, admonish them and desert them in bed and hit them.' It's a command." God willing, we will address all of these controversies, but based on certain principles. First of all, I will not try to embellish this religion. If I try to embellish it, it is as if I'm saying to God, I am beautifying your ugly religion. No, Islam is a beautiful religion. It is in fact the religion that God sent to humanity from the creation of man until the end of time. Islam is perfect. You see, each ideology possesses the characteristics of its founder. Anything human is imperfect because man is imperfect. It can be beautiful though, since humans can be beautiful. But anything divine must be perfect because only the divine is perfect. And Islam is perfect, but it needs to be correctly and properly presented to people. The second principle is that we will not be presenting Islam in an apologetic way. As I said, Islam is a perfect religion, and as the Prophet, peace be upon him, said, in any debate, the religion of God will always be the winner. And as such, there is no need for it to be presented in an apologetic way. The manner in which we will deal with the allegations against Islam will be neither too stern nor too loose. In other words, a way that shows the moderate nature of Islam, since moderation is one of the most important characteristics of Islam. The Quran says, we have made you a moderate or middle nation. Do you know the number of this verse and in which chapter of the Quran it is? It is in Surah Al-Baqarah, or chapter number 2, which has 286 verses. If you divide that by 2, the result is 143. So it is verse number 143 in chapter number 2. So exactly in the middle of the chapter we find the verse, we have made you a moderate or middle nation. Moderation is one of the most important characteristics of Islam, which we intend to convey to the world, particularly in response to the hostile media. The hostile media, which is misrepresenting and tarnishing the image of Islam to the extent that it has become by far the most misunderstood religion in the world. But this is not new. In the Quran, there's a chapter entitled The Poets, which speaks about the hypocrisy of the poets whom we can consider to be the journalists of that time. Prophet Muhammad encouraged other journalists to stand up and explain to the masses the truth about Islam. He encouraged Muslim poets like Hassan ibn Thabit, Abdullah ibn Rawaha, and Ka'b ibn Malik to defend Islam in their poetry. And today, we have to do the same and explain to the masses the true image of Islam. Thank you.